So here we have Jonah of particular fame. You might remember him and a whale, which was actually a great big fish. This is after all that. Jonah has listened to God and he has gone to Nineveh to tell them God's word. And this is actually quite awesome in many, many ways. Why is this awesome? Well, one, Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. Assyria is an empire. Assyria is an empire that has swallowed up Israel. And Assyria has its own God. And yet, well, actually, they have their own many, many, many gods. And yet, Assyria is about to listen to none other than the God of Israel. So, just for our geography experts in the room or on their computers, Nineveh is a city that is now in ruins. It would have been in northern Iraq, just to give you some idea of where it was. And the king of Nineveh, when Jonah finally arrives, actually listens to this no-name prophet from a no-name province of his large, vast, huge, magnificent empire, who represents a god of a little tiny province, sorry, little tiny province of his large, grand, vast, huge empire that is nothing more than a tiny piece of a very large and very complex jigsaw puzzle. Now, what is Job's message from the God of Israel? Basically, that Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, has been evil, it has been wasteful, and as such, in 40 days, it will be no more. It will be destroyed, kaput, the end. There is nothing that Nineveh, the capital of this great empire, can do to stop it. Let's take a moment and pause. 40 days. There's been a bit of a reprieve, mainly because Jonah was running away from the God of Israel. So Nineveh had a bit of a reprieve before its destruction. Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, didn't know that destruction was upon it. It was living in happy ignorance. But now that Nineveh has been given the message, Nineveh knows that its days are quite literally numbered, and those days are numbered 40. And we who have studied the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible know that the number 40 is an important number. To name three instances. The first, the great flood. It rained for 40 days and 40 nights. The second instance, when Moses led the congregation of Israel out of Egypt, they wandered the desert for 40 long, horrible years. And then, moving on to the New Testament, Jesus went into the desert and was tempted by the devil for 40 days and came out the other side victorious. So, we Christians and we who study the Old Testament and the Hebrew Bible know the number 40. We hear the number 40 and we think the God of Israel is involved. But what does the king of Nineveh do? The king of Nineveh would most likely have been the emperor of the entire Assyrian Empire. He is the most powerful man at the planet. On the planet. Now, most men in his position who are approached by a no-name prophet from a no-name province representing a no-name deity, they would just have said, "Oh, yeah, sure, whatever, goodbye," and gone on about their merry business. But the king of Nineveh did not do that. Instead, he fasts. He takes no drink, he takes no food. He takes off his fine clothes and dresses in sackcloth. and he places himself in ashes and dust. These are signs of great mourning. These are signs of great repentance. To those of us who only have a passing familiarity with the Old Testament, we might remember that these are the exact signs that Job uses when he loses everything in the book named after him. But here, in Jonah chapter 3, the king of Nineveh fasts. The nobility of Assyria fasts. The common people of the entire empire fast. And even the beasts of burden fast. Each and every single tier of society take up the acts of mourning. They take up the global repentance. They recognize that they have done wrong. And all of society mourns their own wickedness and repent for it. Imagine if all of American society tomorrow decided that it had been wicked. Choose in your mind for what? Could be anything. Could be for eating cheeseburgers. Could be for not wearing masks. Could be for voting for Biden. Could be for voting for Trump. Could be for voting at all. You choose. And what if we, every single person, from the babies in the hospitals newly born to 100-year-old men and women in nursing homes, what if they all cut their hair close? What if they all took off the powders from their face, took off their makeup? What if they took off their rings, took off their fine jewelry? What if they took off their nice clothes and put on their most simple things? Homespun, no extra dyes, handmade. What if we, as a society, went into the most simplest form of living and went into mass repentance? Imagine that. Imagine all 350 million of us doing that on the turn of a dime. It's difficult to imagine because it's never actually happened before. Not each and every one of us. Not one single tragedy in our history has gotten every single American to mourn with grief, to act in repentance. There have been some top 10 hits, surely, of mourning, but it hasn't been so completely widespread in society. There haven't been mass acts of contrition in the street. We can't quite imagine it because it hasn't actually happened. And yet it happened here when Jonah went to Nineveh and spoke to the king. For those 40 days, an entire empire fasted, wore sackcloth clothing, and sat in ashes and covered themselves with ashes. If you remember Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, and the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground. They were returning to the most simple and basic form that they could. The king of Nineveh expected nothing. Jonah, God's prophet, expected nothing. And yet, after those 40 days of repentance were over, God changed his mind, and Nineveh was saved. Think of America as a society. Think of what we might do if we had one voice and one mind, all lifted up and glorifying the Lord. Might he not smile down upon us as he did upon the wicked kingdom of Nineveh? Think about it. Amen. God, let